its significance in having to be reported to the police if it's lost. That's my first point of clarification. Second, on page 12, the audit around creditors NFI. I'm assuming NFI is the National Fraud Fund. Reference is made to three duplicate payments having occurred. I request them for reasons why they that might have happened. But rather, further down from July, I'm understanding why it occurred and what sums of money might have been involved. comments and two questions, actually.
Regarding the turnaround time, it's a good point that you make, and it is one we have considered that wasn't getting that. The figure that we're using at the moment, the 10-day turnaround, is one that we did a lot of benchmarking work over the last 12 months or so, and I guess some news of the best and their sort of turnaround time between 10 and 14 days, so we thought we'd be covering relatively challenging 10-day turnaround, but it's achievable. We're still doing things achievable, but I'm very mindful, because you're quite right, some of the issues that, that managers are facing outside of, and I'm also very mindful of the fact that you're quite right what you said about this. What I will say is that at the close of every piece of field work that's undertaken, there will be by that stage various sustainable thoughts, views, feelings, findings, being open to the work that's been undertaken. And if there are any sort of significant issues, they're immediately brought to the attention of the manager at that time in a closing meeting. So that meeting gets documented so that it doesn't necessarily sort of influence the review. So if there are any issues that require some agency of attention, we will be looking at the 10-day turnaround period, there's no question there, in light of sort of what's happened across the day. But also, I'd like to go back to the colleagues from the University of North West and just find out what sort of problem they're experiencing and see if they're accepted that to deliver these kind of issues and messages. I'm not averse to sort of have some changes to the way that the report's sort of brought together and how to deliver. So, nothing but the agenda sort of provide a new degree in the right way. To the MacBook, it's a piece of IT equipment, a high value IT equipment.
That's right, I don't understand.
And involved all sorts of issues associated with that, but it was a high value item. I only made a virtual recommendation in relation to the internet system. You want quite a lot of stock of these items and held on your surprise as well. And the arrangements were significant enough, but not shattering his career. Certainly worthy of attention, certainly worthy of us calling back the money from that sort of pay. So but, and in terms of identifying the reasons behind that, it would appear from the work that was done that there's an issue out there in relation to sort of how some of the creditors are registered on the system. If you choose to register a creditor in the name of XYZ, somebody else also have the access to set up that creditor has a limited LAMI-TBD, so they generate two sort of entries on the creditor system. So it's a system issue, but it more a staff educational sort of thing. We need to instill in the staff the need to sort of follow a very detailed sort of steps for how some of these things will be called on the system to avoid these potential failures. You've got two set up. It takes a strange set of circumstances for the two events to be set up by two different people, the same thing, but it does happen on occasion. This sort of national fraud initiative exercise is to sort of try and manage data from within organizations, but also from within organizations, and sure that we're going to a sort of into a number crunching machine that will skip out sort of different payments or payments where the same bank accounts are used. But there are various criteria that you set so they can produce the reports, which are where the events are from investigation. We do hold the way that it's
what you have to have at the moment. Probably also give sort of advanced versions of some of that. Maybe as you say, if once you get the background, if we get some information, I'll send them a reminder email.
It will feature on the bottom of the report that I was talking about sending out this week, so the labour will be able to be included on that report.
That's great, thank you.
Recommendations in terms of the book. Agree? Agree. Agree.
Thank you, Chair. This report is to inform members of the requirements of the new public sector teleworking standards to outline the progress that we've conveyed on the essential compliance results. The standards are jointly developed by the Chartered Institute of Public Accountancy and the Chartered Institute of Internal Auditors. Came into effect with effect on the 1st of April 2013. All local authorities were required to be compliant with these new standards by the 31st of March 2018. The standards effectively replaced the old CIPA code of practice for technical audit for the rulings dating from about 2006 and introduced an additional 142 but challenging requirements with regards to how the technical audit service should be done by the rulings. In response to the standards, I've undertaken a self it's very detailed assessment, which you can imagine, given the sheer number of requirements that they fit within the standards. Detailed self-assessment to evaluate where we sit at this precise moment in time, given that we've got a number of years to ensure that we're all in line. And to the extent of what is actually required for that self-assessment. Now, the outcome of the assessment indicated that we are fully compliant, have evidence to score full compliance in 88%. And further, in the sense where I feel we're far from compliant, where we maybe have policies and procedures in place that cover 89% of the requirement, but there's a further 10% requirement where we might need to sort of fine tune sort of how we identify something within the chance of the strategy or policy, how we go about recording when we do certain things with regards to staff and development. So it is more fine tuning. Certainly no areas of any great significance that we feel we're not compliant. It's my intention to sort of continue to keep you informed as to sort of what progress is made. We do have an action plan there, which includes getting off inspecting items. I'll be happy to circulate that action plan with yourself as we discussed in this sort of briefing, just to give you some feel for in a bit more detail as required in the report.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. As mentioned previously on another occasion, I think under on page 18, that chart 3.3 of the table, I think those items which don't conform, the ones that are above one, I think they don't have some better definition of that for us.
I see that the deadline for compliance is 2018, that's what they seem to be suggesting. I mean, looking at the table that Dave just referred to, 88% seems at first sight to be, you know, quite a high maximum score. However, I'm unable to compare with other councils, so to me, so I don't know whether I mean, come to the conclusion of 88%, I would take a sneak look at other councils' reports to see whether 88% is ahead of the pack or mid-range or is actually quite poor because others are operating from 92. It strikes me it's quite hard for a new standard, but that doesn't compare with what you would consider civil sorts of operations and other councils.
I've spent a lot of time following these things with colleagues from SEBI, the Northwest Chief Board of Executive Group, advisors of some 20 plus councils across the Northwest, where we're in the office of this peer review or process there. So we have sort of pored over this, and I would say that we are comfortably ahead of the pack, as you put it there, because of the work that we've had to do over the last 12, 18 months or so to intend to look sort of around. That's been the most part of the sort of external criticism made when have made some changes to sort of being dependent on the engagement. So you'll see from some of the conditions in the year before that there is a fairly significant development to the place, not least the enhanced engagement itself, the increased reporting, the board and the excellent process that we have been able to see. And I think that the benefit of that would be having to be able to change the cost of work and work at the same time. Others perhaps haven't had the, dare I say, sort of fortune of having that position. It certainly places in a position of strength at the moment. And certainly, when I talk to colleagues, they're asking me, when I talk to colleagues, of using the benefits of Charles as a benefit, so other sort of intent on that they're looking to get that also to sort of make use of, make sure they comply with the requirements of this. I do think we're in a nice position. That's not to say we must have all the trivial evidence that we need to address and some of the sort of fine-tuning is there on assessments and so on. We need to be able to have a moment long before 2018 deadline, so I can certainly get it from the moment sort of next year then.
I think it's worth reflecting on the recommendation that we passed, because you know, for those that have been here a long time, and for newer members outside, it's clear you know, the extra mile, like the 10 miles, the 2 bits that have just gone, and there's 10 in one mile, and it's placed us in this position as a function within the council. I think it's worth acknowledging. That's actually been the case as well, so where we are with the meeting standards.
Yeah, it's good to be ahead of the pack rather than at the back. And if you're on some now, Councillor Sullivan.
Yeah, thanks, Chair. I was just going to say that the last piece that Stuart said there, I think as a deputy, this report, the whole report, is excellently written. It was easy for me to read, and what's more important, it was easy for me to understand as well. And I think it is worth noting, and I hope Stuart does it, but we'll do it if he doesn't. The great strides that we've made in the last 2 years here, and the improvements we've made. And I came on board to Stockwell 2.5 years ago, I think it is now. And I've noticed the improvements that we've made, and reading this report. And as Stuart eloquently put it, we're going to be ahead of the pack. And I think that is worth noting, because it's the improvements that have been made are quite astounding. Thanks, Chair.
Anyone else? Well, the recommendation as it's written is that another report and support the internal audit section can become fully compliant with the public sector internal audit standards. What else did you want to put?
It's probably just be, that the external assessment score stands as a tribute to the hard work carried out by the chief attendants and the staff over the last few years.
All okay with that?
Sure,
Mark. Sure, you will.
Thanks.
Thanks, Mark. Thanks
to
all your staff as
well. Tom, item 5. Actually, I just introduced this because the next 6 items on the agenda are all related to 2013 and 2014 financial year. So just sort of giving some bit of some context for it as well. First report relates to notice by pension. Which the Council's been administered on. That was previously agreed by the Pensions Committee, but of course here because the Council is responsible for the pension to make one part of our accounts. The next item on there is the annual governance statement, which is included in the statement of accounts. Then there's the two key reports from the draft also related to the audit findings and of course the guiding funding. And finally, item 10 on the agenda sort of seeks to bring together all the previous items where we are as this president. September. Just to give you a feel of how those 6 items come together.
Thanks, Chair. Mike Thomas, Grant Thornton, colleagues, for thinking what amount of Grant Thornton. Just going to take you through the final report for the pension fund relatively quickly. This was presented to the Pensions Committee on Monday evening, so I've had a chance to look at it and challenge it and pass on any comments through to this committee. The main findings are on page 25 in your papers. On the left hand side of the page within the introduction, it flags up some things that were still outstanding. Two of those have been completed, which is mainly the final testing around the audit. A number still need completing with their sort of finalisation processes. So following tonight's meeting, we need to get a management letter of representation from the authority. We then do a final post-balance sheet events review and then final procedures on in terms of checking the final accounts to before we issue the opinion. Moving to the right hand side of that page, anticipation is an unqualified opinion because, as I'll go on to say, there are no changes in terms of the numbers in the accounts, small number of disclosure changes. We also, in the appendix to the report, our draft audit opinion in there, and that also includes our draft audit opinion on the annual report, which we're required to give, and a draft letter of representation, which, as I say, we need to require signing after tonight's meeting. Just reflecting on the second second paragraph in that side of the page, actually, having been here as the auditor for 7 years, I can remember back, and it just shows how the value of investments changed that back in 2000, I think was 2007, Amy Donald will probably tell me if I'm wrong, when that value was 3.8 billion rather than 6.1 billion now, so in the previous 6 or 7 years, I have no influence on that whatsoever, but it's nice to see it's going in the right direction. So it really just making the point that it is a big fund in the context of pension funds across the country. But in terms of the audit opinion, it's the same unqualified opinion, some small amounts of changes which are flagged up at page 31. And as we've done in previous years, I would just like to thank the finance staff within the pension fund for their assistance in helping us get through the audit process and the way they presented the accounts and the working papers, which allowed us, as this report says, to be completed by early September. In terms of the rest of the report, it sort of follows the audit plan that came to the committee earlier in the year, and from 28, 29, 30 on, which just reflects the key items within the accounts, the work we've done, and then whether there are any issues arising. As I've said, there are no significant issues to bring to your attention. Further through the report, we are required to communicate certain other things to you. So on page 32, we're flagging that there are some small areas around IT controls, which I will comment on further in the main Wirral report, because we look at that control environment in the context of Wirral and the pension fund together. But nothing of a significant nature. We're also required on page 33 to bring to your attention any matters we find in relation to fraud, laws and regulations, other disclosures, related parties or going concern, and again there are nothing to bring to your attention there. Also required to bring to your attention our fees, which are on page 35, and they've not changed from the audit plan. And maybe just for members' information, on page 37, there are significant changes going on in relation to the pension scheme, and they're sort of captured on one slide there, and just to flag up for the firm and SIPPA nationally and regionally are doing training sessions on these issues and some of those changes in the next month or two. So if members are interested, then they're welcome to come along to those. So I'd take any questions, Chair.
Any questions? No? Sir, what's Mike?
This is the statement of accounts of the earnings by pension fund. As Mike mentioned, the board providing the board of pension statement of accounts for the pension committee on Monday night, and we're agreeing. Come here, bring to the balance of members, there are no changes to the accounts for the pension. There are some changes to the disclosures within the statements, and for this committee, the letter of representation has been agreed by the pension committee on the different boards of priority. That will be sent to the auditors, and then we'll follow the issue of the auditors again. I can take any questions. I'll talk about the case of the pension fund, just around the detail of the pension fund. Any questions?
Any questions? Do we agree with the recommendation?
Thanks, Chair. I'm going to introduce this to the committee. This is the second time I've brought a statement to this committee, Chair. I guess this time last year, I was a little embarrassed to say some of the things and to present some of the things to you, because whilst there was a tremendous amount of work in progress, I think there was left in some time in terms of the progress that had been made. So having been brought together this year, it is a good news item for the